side, there is enough money, but the capital markets definitely need to be geared up for channeling that money. And the pension fund which have the money need to have a vehicle in which they can put this money. On the government side, political will is not lacking, plenty of it. The local government, however, has some limitations in the amount of money they can borrow, except for the cities of Astana and Almaty. And the federal government is supporting the capital investments in infrastructure and also supporting the operation maintenance costs. So there is money flowing from the federal government. The issue is how can this, from the Ministry of Finance side, be something which can come down over a period of time. And then when you look at the public-private partnerships and the private sector participation, here the challenge specifically is that this is still not happening to the extent in the urban sector one would like to see it happen. And that's where I think one would like to focus upon as to what needs to make it happen. And over here I think it's the creation of the enabling environment, talking of the projects which have successfully done, and then looking at creating a pipeline of bankable projects. All of this is something which needs to be done. Now in ADB, when we are looking at the PPP operational plan, the reason for putting up this slide is that we recognize that the money which the IFS can bring to the countries is going to be limited, is indeed much less than what is required as an investment in these countries. And therefore the way in which we can leverage the money with other partners, with co-financing and with the private sector is the way in which we should look at meeting the investment gaps. And therefore when we are screening the projects, we are screening the projects with the priority of having the private sector participation followed by PPP as the way in which we are looking at using the resources we have before we come to the plain vanilla lending which is being done by ADB with many other countries. Now when you come to, let's say, the prioritization of projects, quite often one goes through this term value for money, and there's going to be one more presentation also following me on this from Japan, so I won't go into the details, but I would like to point out one specific thing, that while you expect that the most efficient partner, be it the public or the private, who can do the services and deliver the services efficiently, is the one who does the project, one should also keep in mind the recent recommendations which has been done by the Private Finance Initiative in the UK, and that is saying that for value of money, that will be improved only when the officials are proactive, and it also then means that there are many conditions which need to be existing over there. It can be conditions related to the way in which the skills exist, it can be conditions related to what information exists, it also can be establishing effective arrangements for meeting the challenges, and also necessary stop signs have to be put on place if the things are not meeting the requirements. And also, lastly, the commercial awareness needs to be there on both the sides, so that what risk can be taken and how it can be shared is also something which needs to be brought to the table. So I would strongly urge that we don't apply value for money as something which can be done from day one. It needs a lot of background, it needs a lot of information, data and skills, and it definitely needs to be there nevertheless. Another factor which is required is about how do you fund the project development expenses. And then project development fund is one way in which one can do this, where on one side, by setting up these funds, you are enabling certain amount of fund flow for managing the expenses to prepare bankable projects. You also are then looking at having various transaction advisory services being brought to the table with that money, who are knowledgeable of doing these services and making these projects bankable. With a balanced risk sharing, and you're also looking at then having the first pilot projects becoming the showcases for having more projects to come in. But currently I think what is missing is the absence of these funds which can facilitate PPPs. And then coming to facilitating PPPs, I think the institutional setup is something which is often very strongly relevant or sometimes prevents PPPs from happening. The risk management unit is a part of that. Second is the way in which project viability gap funding is done for ensuring that the revenue flow for the project utility company is adequate to meet its investment liabilities. And third is looking at how market financing facilitation can be done in a manner in which the funds available in the market flow to these projects. So all of these are the steps. I'm not comprehensive, but just indicating some of of them, which are required to make these things happen. Now, as a last slide, I just want to make a mention over here that if you want to therefore look at transitioning to an alternate financing mechanism, there can be many ways of doing this. I'm just alluding to one example. And that one example is trying to contrast that in a plain vanilla transaction, typically the government as the public sector gives a debt for the project, and then you have a project utility which takes the money as capital expenditure and then creates the infrastructure. Quite often the operation maintenance expenses are not fully met, and the assets therefore don't live the complete economic life. Now this is the sort of plain vanilla thing which keeps on happening. And looking at Kazakhstan, where the government is quite keen to see private sector comes in strongly, on one hand you see over here therefore that you can think of a mechanism where the government along with the financial institutions and co-financers look at first breaking the chicken and egg. Currently private sector, which is not willing to bite the bullet to take the risk, can come in at least for the sake of the first 5 to 7 years, where it is talking of doing the construction of the projects and then de-risking these projects to a stage where they are available for further operation and maintenance and for further running and giving of the services. Now while this first part is taking place, what is important is trying to see that we set up an institutional mechanism. And over here one example given is having a holding company through which these funds can be channeled into a utility which is then looking at using this money, and then you can have the local banks also involved in that, so that you can create this asset. And then the second step is actually the most important step of trying to have a credible exit mechanism for the government which wants the private sector to come in. And that exit mechanism is trying to see how the takeout financing, both in debt and equity, can be made possible by making these projects bankable. This is also the time when the projects which are coming up after this de-risking are the ones which can be rated in the market, and those are the ones in which the pension funds can also have their investments flowing in. So with this type of a two-step approach, in most of the cases, it's possible then to create first the projects and then looking at handing it over to the private sector. Now, intrinsically, if a project is bankable, you don't need these steps. So I want to again qualify that this is just one example where the private sector is hesitant to come in, and this is the way in which you can take the chicken and egg to go forward. And then institutions like ADB and other financial institutions can therefore give a wrap around these projects to reduce the risk of the project by giving partial guarantees or having a mechanism which can strengthen the credit rating of that project. And then with that approach, as more projects keep on rolling, you can have more utilities which can be funded through the special purpose vehicle. And therefore, in order to trigger this intervention, it is necessary that in the period of first 5 to 7 years, the necessary reforms are done. Reforms in both at the project level and the tariff, and reforms in the enabling environment which allow the private sector to have confidence to make those investments. And finally, through this mechanism, then when you are actually allowing the private sector to come in, that's the stage when the project is bankable and it's something which is credit worthy, it is investment worthy from a pension fund's perspective. And that's when the government can exit and you can have long-term financing coming in through examples like the Development Bank of Kazakhstan or the pension funds, or and of course the private sector, who can bring in both debt and equity. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Sukumar. And again, making a very difficult topic very easy for us to understand and offer solutions. Is there anyone in the audience who would like to ask a question? Yes, please. Stand over there. Is there anyone? It's a chance of a lifetime. No. Can I ask you one question? One of my advisors. Oh, sorry. Is there somebody? No. I said a value for money is not a Christmas present. You have to work hard for it. Can you give examples where, in your experience, how you can create value for money for 5 or 10 years or 50 years if the contract is running?
I think take the example of currently you have either the public sector or the private sector, both of whom can invest in the project, and then you're making a decision who can do it more efficiently, you're at a different level. But if you're taking a decision that I don't have the money, and I'm also not necessarily having the efficiency of doing it, and then start doing a comparison, is the value of money for public or the private sector to invest, that can be a difficult proposition in the absence of information and data. So you need to be extremely cautious as to what stage you are in before you take the approach of doing the value for money comparison to decide the public or the private sector should come in. That's what I meant.
Good. Thank you very much. If there are no questions, oh, there are. Good. Please state your name and ask questions. Yes.
My name is Janat Salimovatikai. I work for Ernst & Young. I head the Department for Project Finance and Infrastructure. I would like to ask a question with regard to your last slide, which in my mind was the hit. And that slide offers an alternative to this transitional financing. And my question relates to the currency risk. It doesn't seem like the currency risk is featured in any manner on that slide. And in my mind, and I'm sure there will be many who would agree with me, this is a very important issue for urban PPPs, where most of revenues come in local currency, and the financing, it seems, has to come in foreign currency. Would you be able to comment on that point? Thank you.
In fact, over here, as I said, I didn't go through the complete detailing of this, which by itself is a presentation of mine. But over here, we are looking at having local currency bonds. So the local currency bonds are the ones which are looking at financing this project, and then therefore de-risking the projects from the foreign exchange risk, which typically is going to be there for some of the other projects. And that, I think, answers the question that why is local currency not there on that slide? That's because of the availability of local currency bonds in the local market.
That's the last question, because then we go to the next speaker.
I have a quick, my name is Carl Johannesson. I'm not from Ernst & Young, there are two Carl Johannessons here. I have a quick question to Sir Stubbart and to Ishan Welkenbach. I have a feeling that some of the speakers see the bottle as half empty and some as half full. And we also have a bottle from the Public-Private Partnership Fund. My question is, what is the typical size of a viable project that could develop in Kazakhstan? What type of size and what type of sector? And my question to Shomar Abdizov is, do you have an idea for a short list of potential PPPs or sectors that...